Hello, listeners. This podcast is made possible thanks to several things. One of those things is donations, and you can donate to the podcast using one of the yellow PayPal donate buttons on my website. The other thing that helps the podcast going is Luke's English Podcast Premium, which, as you know, is my other service, and it contains loads of episodes, video, audio, PDFs, which are designed to help you build your vocab, improve your grammar, and work on your pronunciation too. And for a small price per month, you get access to the entire library and all the new content that comes. And the money that I make from that kind of gets recycled back into the podcast and also pays for the time I can spend on doing this. And so there you go. If you're interested in Luke's English Podcast Premium, go to teacherluke.co.uk/premium info to find out more. You're listening to Luke's English Podcast. For more information, visit teacherluke.co.uk. Hello, listeners. How are you today? This episode is called Conspiracies, UFOs, Life Hacks with James. And I'm going for the full Joe Rogan clickbait title here, as you will see later. I've said before that I wonder if clickbait titles actually work. I think they do. And whether I should use them, I'm still not sure about that. I guess we'll find out with this episode, which is a rambling conversation with my brother. Clickbait, by the way, is any content on the internet which is designed just to get you to click it. It's spelled C-L-I-C-K-B-A-I-T, one word, clickbait. And it's usually some kind of sensational title or a promise of amazing exclusive information, which is often not actually included. Usually they're there as bait for clicks, which ultimately will be turned into advertising revenue. Clickbait titles, examples would be things like this. Dermatologists hate her new skincare routine that will save you thousands. Or like a YouTube video like, why Jabba the Hutt is the key to the Skywalker bloodline in ways you couldn't imagine. 10 life hacks guaranteed to change the way you live forever. Or proof that aliens have already landed and are living among us. 7 secrets about COVID-19 that the government don't want you to know. Or these simple language hacks will help you speak like a native overnight. So those are some examples of clickbait titles. I personally hate clickbait, but as an online content creator, I'm drawn to and fascinated by the impact of attention-grabbing, wildly sensational titles. They obviously work, that's the thing, because they're everywhere. But a lot of the time, I find clickbait titles annoying and even depressing because it's so devious and also hackneyed. Anyway, for this episode, I've gone with the simple Conspiracies, UFOs, Life Hacks as a title. It's clickbait-ish with certain buzzwords that seem to attract attention. But really, this is just a bit of a joke, as you'll hear in the episode. Let's see if it makes any difference. Anyway, what are you going to listen to in this episode then? Well, the other evening, I called my brother James and I started recording our conversation before he answered the call, which I probably shouldn't have done because he wasn't expecting a podcast recording at this time. But I pressed record before he'd even picked up, and what resulted was a spontaneous chat that ended up going all Joe Rogan as we talked about UFOs, conspiracy theories, and life hacks. First of all, there's a bit of a catch-up and a chat about the COVID situation and how James has been handling it. And then we get on to some of the major topics of our time, including whether we are alone in the universe, how to cook poached eggs, how to walk upstairs, how not to make British tea, the Beatles meeting Elvis, some sketchy impressions of celebrities, a dodgy chair, and what you should do with overripe bananas, as opposed to what you shouldn't do with overripe bananas. Here's what you should do with overripe bananas. I hope you enjoy it. I'll be back at the end to chat to you again with some music going on in the background, as usual, I expect. But now let's call my brother and see what happens. Here we go. So I'm about to start podcasting with my brother. I've got no idea what we're going to talk about. We've got no agenda for this at all. So I've set up a meeting on the old Zoom platform, the one that we've been using so much during the lockdown. It's in the evening. It's getting in fairly late. I've set up the Zoom meeting. I'm in Zoom now, waiting for James to arrive. I've emailed him all the details. Let's see what happens in this conversation. I don't think he'll be prepared for the fact that we're already recording. I'm going to surprise him with that one. I wonder how he's going to react when he realizes that we're already recording. We will see. And I wonder what kind of topics are going to come up. What kind of language you're going to hear? What are the things that we're going to talk about? James is saying the internet is slow as fuck at the moment. Which is not a good sign. Does that mean he's trying to sign in? He's communicating with me via WhatsApp at the moment. He's saying that might be a problem. We will see when he finally joins this call. Still waiting. Shall I write to him? What's going on? Question mark. I'm writing. I'm recording. I'm already recording, by the way. Okay. So I don't know how he's going to respond to that. Is this exciting? No, not really. It's a little bit boring. Oh, that's a pity. So it's late-ish in the evening. It's about 10 p.m. where I am. And so I'm quite tired. I have to admit, I've had a few beers this evening, which is kind of normal-ish of an evening. I might sort of crack open a couple of beers while I am feeding my daughter her dinner and generally looking after her and stuff in the evening. So I am sort of several beers under. I've had my dinner. Delicious. Cooked by my wife. Oh, that was good. She made us some steak, and then she made a kind of avocado, tomato and onion thing to go on the side. Very good. So James is joining the meeting. I'm going to admit him. Here he is. Does he know that we're already recording? I wonder how he will react. It's exciting. Here he is. Okay, what's his sound going to be like? The sound quality, probably terrible. I'll have to work through all that stuff with him, no doubt, as is normal, you know. On Zoom calls, you're constantly asking people, can you know, your microphone is muted, blah, blah, blah. And here he is. He's about to join us. I feel like there should be a jingle at this point, but there isn't. All I've got is a black screen. Oh, I can see my brother. He's got a headset on.
One, two.
Yes, we've got
you. You're getting something.
Yes.
Good.
Okay. So I've been podcasting for now for about 9 minutes.
Okay. Why did you do that?
I don't know. I just thought that it would be exciting to start podcasting before I actually talk to you. And then we could just, we can hit the ground running, so to speak.
Yeah. So it means we don't have any sort of time for any sort of off mic chat now, though, doesn't it?
Nope. It's all going out. It's all rolling out onto the podcast.
Basically, what happens is I say, hey, Luke, fancy a chat? And you say, yeah, I need to do a new podcast, actually. Brotherly chat turned into content, hard content.
Wait, is that what happened this evening?
That's what happened.
Really? You thought it would just be a normal Skype call, and now here I am turfing you out onto the podcast.
I suggested we just have a chat.
Oh, right. Oh, I didn't realize that you thought it would just be a normal...
Just trying to guilt trip
Just you, normal relationship-level conversation.
That's fine.
Have you been using Zoom a lot during the lockdown, or what?
No, only early on with you and the rest of the family.
Mm-hmm.
I think I used it one other time with some sort of ex-colleagues when we had a bit of a chat.
Okay.
Early on in the sort of quarantine-y sort of time.
And how have you been, keeping busy during the period?
I've been making a lot of tunes.
Okay.
Which is something that is my kind of go-to thing to do when I'm a bit bored.
Mm-hmm.
Bordering on obsessive compulsive disorder.
You've been very prolific, actually, during the lockdown. I mean,
I've been making, like, probably just under a tune a day, or at least, like, say, 4 or 5 a week.
It's great.
That's not necessarily such a good thing, because they're not all that great, but a couple of them are okay. A couple of them are quite good.
My listeners will know your tunes from those moments at the end, usually these days, of episodes, when after the main content is finished and I do a sort of outro, at the end. Is outro the word I was talking
that's
about?
That's what everyone says.
So I was doing an outro. I do outros, and I usually have a bed of music underneath it. And I almost always choose one of your tunes, and the recent ones you've done have been really good.
Well, I think they have improved since, because we talked on the podcast, your podcast before, about me making music with the MPC and everything. And I think if I listen back to those now, I've definitely improved as far as the kind of sound quality goes and the sort of overall standard, I suppose. But it's so slow, you know. It feels like getting better at such small increments, you know.
Mm.
I feel like I got quite good very quickly, and then I've been slowly just crawling my way slightly better, but feels a bit painfully slow sometimes.
You've hit the intermediate plateau.
I have.
You have to keep going.
Well, unfortunately, the disk drive broke on my MPC yesterday.
No, really?
So it's all right. I've replaced one before. I mean, they're quite user-friendly as far as taking them apart and having a bit of a dig around.
Yeah.
Although last time I did it, there were quite a few screws left over.
Really? That's worrying. If you've repaired something and you realise there's a few screws left over.
Okay. And some sort of essential cooling element. No, not the cooling element.
Yeah.
I'm making that up. But, so, yeah, I've been kind of like a bit like, oh, God, I had to go for a walk today and I had to cook myself dinner and all this constructive stuff, or I'd normally be sat hunched over a machine.
Right, because the machine was broken, so you had to actually do normal life.
To do useful stuff, yeah.
Have you found that the lockdown has made you, has it changed your lifestyle at all?
I think I've got quite sort of agoraphobic tendencies anyway sometimes.
What does that mean?
Well, that's an exaggeration, but I'm quite happy to stay indoors quite a lot of the time.
Yeah, me too.
I'm quite, I suppose you could say lazy, but I don't know. I'm just quite comfortable pottering around the house, really.
Mm-hmm.
So it hasn't been that bad. And I've had some work. I mean, work's obviously slowed right down.
Yeah.
But I've had some bits of work to keep ticking over. And yeah, it's been all right. It was weird just at the start when everyone was kind of in panic mode.
Mm.
And mum and dad even suggested that I could go up and stay with them.
You didn't want to do that?
Well, it was, you know, a nice offer and everything, but I thought I'd probably, we'd probably annoy each other. I'd probably annoy them, or they'd annoy me or something.
Wait, which one would it be? That you would annoy them or they would annoy you?
I think we'd mutually annoy each other eventually.
In what ways?
Well, just because I'm not used to living at home, well, you know, in the family home with parents or anything.
Okay.
So I think it was for the best that I didn't do that.
It would be like when you were a teenager again, wouldn't it?
Well, that's... No.
No?
No, it wouldn't, but it still wouldn't be good.
Okay. What was it like when you were a teenager? Do you remember?
Oh, Luke, I'm sure you'll remind us.
No, I was just wondering if you wanted to...
Yes, I do remember. I do remember, yes.
Mm. Oh, he's got up from his chair. Just wandering over to get his water. Okay. All right. So right. What's the scene, man, in London, man, on the street and all that stuff? What's going down in Groovetown?
Well, it's starting to get more busy now, but it's still quite quiet on the streets.
Mm-hmm.
It was very quiet the first few weeks. You know, eerily quiet.
Yeah.
A bit 28 days later sort of vibe.
28 days later.
Which is not my favourite film, but it's a zombie film or zombie type film set in London, where there's one scene where he walks around the streets and they're all deserted. And he walks around all the landmarks and everything and there's no one there except piles of litter.
Yeah.
So it's pretty much like that.
Yeah, so it was a bit like that in Paris as well. Actually, like sort of deserted streets. It was kind of great in a way.
I enjoyed skateboarding around.
Yeah?
Yeah, that's quite nice. Because I think a lot of people, not everyone, but a certain percentage of people sort of left London.
Yeah.
Because there was all sorts of scare stories about the army being brought in and potential, you know, rioting or looting and stuff, none of which happened.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it felt very quiet. It's starting to get back to normal, but it's still quiet. I went out, you know, on the way back earlier. It's definitely a lot less busy. I don't know how you...
It's kind of a bit more like normal.
A quarter busy.
Yeah. Here it's...
Before it was an eighth busy.
Here it's like, in a way, even busier than it normally would be. Like, to counteract the fact that they don't want people to gather inside restaurants and that the weather is quite nice... Like, so much more space has been given to restaurants putting their tables out in the street. So a lot of parking spaces have been sort of closed off with little pallets, like, made into these little walls. And inside there are loads of tables and chairs, and there's just, like, everyone is out on the terraces having their evening meals and drinking their wine and stuff like that. It's crazy. It really is. So during the lockdown, I mean, I suppose, yeah, you said you quite like being sort of stuck at home, actually.
Well, it was a bit weird. It was kind of a slightly freaky, especially in those first few weeks when there was lots of kind of panicky, I don't know, the coverage was a bit... I mean, no one really knew what the score was, and people still don't really know what the score is. So it's kind of, you know, it was weird.
Well,
Everyone was like, I wasn't going out to the shops. I wasn't going out at all. I was getting food delivered and I was like washing everything and, you know, just following everything to the letter. And then as it's gone on, I've started going to the food shop now and haven't socialized very much. I've seen a couple of friends in the park and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But I went for a skate a few times. I don't know where that conversation was going.
Well, did the paranoid part of you ever start to think that there was something funny going on with the whole COVID situation?
Well, you mean like a conspiracy theory type thing?
Yeah.
Well, there's obviously people that do think a bit like that, and you can see why, because it's kind of like you have to take all the evidence on face value, and it's kind of unseen, you know, sort of an invisible thing. Yeah. And when you ask around and nobody you know has got it, you start to question it. Well, I don't particularly, because I trust the people that are on the BBC, for instance, and friends of mine are in the NHS.
Yes.
One of my friends is a nurse, and she was saying, yeah, it's just ridiculous. It's been, everything's full, you know. And my friend who's a doctor told me the same thing, and she said, the NHS has coped, but only because they've cancelled everything else.
God, yeah, really.
So all the people with, you know, long-term treatments or things that are ongoing or even cancer treatments have just been cancelled.
Yeah, right.
With the demand from COVID-19. So it's definitely real.
Yeah.
But some people are, you know, there's a lot of skepticism and, you know, people don't know what to believe. And it's, you know, you can understand that because it's all new, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. Yeah, I've never experienced this before.
I don't think we'll really know what it's all about for like 10 years, you know, when the public inquiries have come out and, you know.
Yeah. But imagine if it turns out that it's some manufactured sort of bioweapon.
I don't think you should be spreading conspiracy theories.
I'm not. I really don't believe the conspiracy theories. I don't. So, but I, you know, I find them quite interesting to talk about.
But you can't just make these statements. You need to have facts to back it up.
Yeah, of course. I'm not spreading conspiracy theories. Jesus Christ. I'm not like the Joe Rogan Experience podcast or anything where they're like, you know, giving hours and hours of stuff to genuine conspiracy theory nonsense.
Speaking of which, didn't you tell me, sorry.
Yeah, Paris, go on.
Can you finish your sentence? But no, just while I remember, didn't you tell me that it was World UFO Day today?
I think it was Mum who said that on WhatsApp, that it's World UFO Day today.
So that's quite a good topic.
Yeah, UFOs. So, what do you think about UFOs then?
I mean, you said you wanted to go for clickbait on this one, right?
Yeah.
So, life hacks, UFOs, and
what are the life hacks? We haven't talked about life hacks.
I'll come to those.
Talk about life hacks then.
Yeah.
So, life hacks, UFOs.
What's another good one? We're not gonna have. Conspiracy theories, though.
No conspiracy theories, really? You sure?
And conspiracy theories, but as in, we're just saying they're...
COVID conspiracies.
No.
COVID conspiracies and life hacks. And what was the other one? Joe Rogan, the UFOs, that's it.
UFOs.
Okay, so what are your UFO stories then? Go on. You got some UFO shit.
I've got some UFO experience.
Oh, really?
Well, you know this story. When I was about 12, I was reading the local paper, and there was an article about this guy who was supposedly a UFO expert, and he'd taken all these photos of UFOs, and he was giving a talk about them in Solihull.
Yeah.
And they printed all these photos of UFOs, and they were like amazing photos.
How? How amazing?
Like, clearly fake.
So, describe the photos if you can.
Like a detailed UFO shot from above in a sort of canyon.
Right, okay.
You know, but like, yeah, he was obviously a model. I mean, they were really well taken shots, but they were just clearly fake. They were just too good. And they were from the wrong angles and things like that. It was just like, come on.
Yeah.
And it wasn't even, it was just like, and there was no like evidence for it. And this guy was clearly talking out of his ass because he's never heard of again, you know. It was it was just fake photos of UFOs. So I was like, I can't believe they put that in the paper. So I stuck a bit of black card on my window.
You cut out a piece of black card into the shape?
Yeah, just a little roughly cut out in the shape of UFO. Stuck it on the window and took a photo with like an instant camera through the window so you can see the little black mark.
Yeah.
When I got it, I think I got it developed the next day or something because I wanted to get this back. And I sent it into the paper and I said, I read with interest your article, but probably not in such wanky language. I read your 12-year-old. I read your story about UFOs, and I found it very interesting. Here's, by coincidence, I saw a UFO yesterday. Right. Here's the photo as proof. I think it's just as authentic as any of the photos that you printed. See, satire. And they printed it. And the next day I was at work in the orange tree, like, cleaning glasses or something, and everyone's like, did you really see a UFO? Because they printed my address and everything, you know, like this. And all the pot washers and chefs and stuff, fucking hell, did you see a UFO? And I was like, no, it was a very clever letter explaining to them that they, you know, and they were just like, but did you see a UFO?
Oh, that's good. You just completely faked it really easily.
Well, it was obviously a fake. The one that I sent in was like, you know, terrible.
Yeah, it was obviously a piss take, and they published it with tongue in cheek.
It was quite good. It looked good in print because that sort of half tone of the print process kind of covered up the sort of crappy edges of the
special effects that you'd chosen to use.
It looked a bit more authentic in print somehow.
Right.
But so that's my UFO experience. And we were talking today about the Rendlesham incident, weren't we, Suffolk.
What's the Rendlesham incident? Rendlesham?
It's a US Army base in Suffolk.
Suffolk in England, in East England. East Anglia in England. Suffolk, there's a US Army base there.
And I haven't got any of the information, but there was a site, was it in early 80s? I'm just going to quickly look.
Is it WR for Rendlesham or is it just R?
1980.
The Rendlesham Forest Incident, 1980.
So I won't bother reading the Wikipedia page. You can look it up. But some army personnel, army security, were called out to the woods nearby the army base. Reports of strange lights. And they made a recording, an audio recording, of them going through the trees and being very, very spooked out. What's that?
I just put an emoticon thumbs up into Skype in order to say, yes, nice one, this is good. And I thought it would be like a little thing, and you're like, oh, stop the story. What's that?
Creepy.
There's a little thumb giving a thumbs up. Yeah. Anyway, I mean, I like this, carry on.
You don't do that, though. You don't go...
Just raise your thumb randomly.
Raise your thumb and press it back down again. It looks disgusting.
Creepy.
Anyway, so they thought they saw something, and then some other guys went back a second night, and there's all these stories which get better each time they're told.
Excellent.
Like the original tape, they didn't really see anything except lights.
Mm-hmm.
And I think because it was the middle of the night and it was in a forest and it was probably very spooky, they got really scared.
Yeah.
And their imaginations got the better of them.
Yes, okay.
Because there's this theory that there was actually a lighthouse nearby.
Right.
And lights that they see through the trees and the mist coincide exactly with the rotation of the lighthouse.
Ah.
So they're going, there's lights. Do you see them? Do you see them again? The light through the forest. And then he goes, it's gone. Okay. It's come back. It's moving right, from left to right.
Right, right, right.
And all this stuff. And everything else has been built up over time and got better and better and better and better until it, in this one general guy, I don't know. I think he's just become a ufologist in retirement, basically just dining off this story.
Yeah. Ufologist.
The other guy. This is my take on it. I don't know. And he in the end, he says, and I saw this triangular shaped spacecraft, and I think it was either of alien origin or from another dimension. Because, well, how fucking objective?
Either yeah. It was from
how very scientific of you.
Either of alien origin or from another dimension, and that's not alien then. Like if it's from another dimension.
How did you come to that conclusion that it was from another dimension?
Yeah.
Well, how much do you know about dimensions, mate? Exactly.
There's literally anything's possible in another dimension.
They're full of, you know, it's a good story. I like it as a story, and I think it's a good story of how things become legend and how things get better as they're told.
Yes. You've never seen a UFO yourself, then?
A UFO is just something that you don't know the identity of, isn't it?
Yeah, you don't know what it is, yeah.
Not really.
You never seen anything flying in the sky, you didn't know what it was?
I don't think so.
I once saw a meteor. Have I told you this? I must have told you this story. I told you this story?
Try me.
I think I did. I remember you were living abroad. Not abroad, no. You were living
in Kent.
You were living in, Cambridge at the time. I was with Paul Breeze,
mm-hmm.
our mate from back home, back out in the sticks when we lived in the middle of nowhere in a little town called Chadwick End. Google it, folks. Google it. Chadwick End. You'll find it in the West Midlands. Chadwick, C-H-A, I can reveal this because we don't live there anymore. C-H-A-D-W-I-C-K, End, Chadwick End, out there in Solihull. I was with Paul Breeze, and we were out the back of the garden house because we were lucky enough to have this little sort of what used to be a double garage separate from the house, and my parents kind of put some carpets and sofas and stuff in there. So we were out the back of that having a cigarette, and in the distance over the fields we saw something drop from beneath the clouds.
Yeah.
And it was, it had a trail of smoke coming behind it, and it had an orange glow. It was obviously on fire.
Wow.
A ball of fire dropped down beneath the line of clouds in the very distance.
Yeah.
You were looking above the hedges, and there's cloud, and then you can see like electricity pylons in the distance. And so it dropped down from the cloud, and it was glowing orange, left a trail of smoke with it. And it slowly went out as it dropped, and it must have landed somewhere out there. In the middle of the Warwickshire countryside.
Mad. Was there ever reported?
No, I never saw anything about it afterwards. Mm.
But I mean, I've seen some great stuff. Seen some great videos of like dash cams.
Yeah.
Of meteors and stuff.
Well, there were those ones in Russia. Is it Chelyabinsk? Is that where they landed?
I think so.
Yeah, that's a massive thing that like exploded high above the ground, but it was like the combination of explosions of these meteors was like bigger than any atomic bomb that's ever gone off. It was like 9 atomic bombs all together or something like that. It was completely crazy.
What? In the air above?
Yeah. When those meteors exploded in the air above a town in Russia, the explosions were like greater than sort of many atomic bombs together. It's insane.
So
isn't it?
People get killed.
It was high. It was high enough in the atmosphere for it just to blow out windows and knock people over and stuff like that. You know, postmen dropped all their letters on the floor and things like that sort of thing. Yeah. So, never seen a UFO. Would you like to be abducted by UFOs, like in that film Close Encounters of the Third Kind, the Martin Scorsese, Steven Spielberg?
That would be a different film, wouldn't it?
Hey, you fucking alien fucks! You are you fucking with me? Yeah. You fucking moke. Come on. Imagine that, Robert De Niro versus aliens. Hey, you fucking, those your fucking fingers or your fucking thumbs? I can't fucking tell, huh?
That was more like Sonny from The Godfather.
Yeah, well, could be that as well. So yeah, if you got sort of caught up with aliens and shit, would you be up for an abduction or?
No, not really. Not into the probing and stuff.
Really? Because he's pretty keen to do it. Old Richard Dreyfuss in Close Encounters of the Third Kind. He's up for it.
Well, he's been sort of,
brainwashed.
He's been sort of brainwashed.
Yeah.
I mean, if I start making any weird shapes out of mashed potato, then I'll call somebody. I'll call, what's the NHS hotline?
Will Smith, no? It's a pretty good film, isn't it? It's Close Encounters. He has a close encounter with a UFO, and then after that he has visions, and he's constantly trying to create this shape out of all the materials in front of him, and he's like making this shape out of the mashed potato his wife has presented with him with, and then some mud and sand and stuff, and it turns out to be a big mountain, and he's like making the shape of this mountain, and one day he sees it on TV and he heads there, and that's where the aliens land. It's pretty crazy shit.
It's quite sort of positive though, isn't it? I mean, it's like
they're good guys, aren't they, the aliens?
Yeah, but so are the Americans,
the government.
Yeah. They're quite, they're not like, let's shoot these commie bastards or something.
Did you see the footage that was released by the Pentagon earlier this year of UFO footage? It's pretty weird.
Yeah. Hard to know what to make of that.
We don't know what that stuff is, and neither do they, do they?
Hmm. Well, maybe it's just them going, look, we've got access to some alien tech that you don't have, so... And that's what UFOs are all about.
Yeah.
You know the shape of a UFO? It looks like a saucer.
Yes.
That was to detract people from thinking that they might be a wing, like the stealth bomber, which in silhouette or profile looks very much like a disc.
Oh, really?
So the idea of a disc, some people think, was put about so that if anyone saw strange flying shapes, they'd think they were a disc rather than a wing.
Oh, I see. So you've got discs in your head, and you look at something
you think, oh, it's a disc. There's a big disc in the sky. It's actually a very flat wing.
It's not NASA's new hypertech.
If you look at the silhouette of a stealth bomber, it's like flat with a little dimple at the top.
Yeah, but UFO-ish.
Classic UFO shape, yeah.
What do you think happened at Area 51? Do you remember in the 90s, James, when, let's say, 1994, 1993, 1993, 1994, everyone was complete. The X-Files was on TV. Everyone was mental about aliens. And
Everyone had a poster on their wall saying, take me to your dealer.
Yeah, there was like posters of aliens, take me to your dealer, not take me to your leader. Posters of aliens, aliens on TV, aliens, aliens, aliens.
An alien dressed as like Dirty Harry. Have you seen that one?
No.
Dirty Harry, but it's an alien.
And it's like an alien.
What's the relevance?
A dreadlock rasta alien smoking a spliff. That sort of thing as well. So why did I start asking you this? That in the 90s, so we were all obsessed with aliens. I don't know why.
Yeah, Area 51.
Area 51. So what do you think about it? Because we were all talking about it. What do you think went on there?
Isn't it like a military testing base?
I think so.
So, well, it's probably military testing stuff then, isn't it?
But it's pretty weird that if people are seeing stuff like triangles in the sky flying in different directions...
I think they're probably unlikely to be of alien origin.
The thing that was there originally was that apparently an alien crash landed, and then the government stepped in and said that it was a balloon crash or a balloon accident, and it was parts of a balloon that were lost there.
It's still just a big blah blah.
Do you remember?
It's too far away. Aliens aren't going to come here. The distances are too far.
Mm-hmm.
It's just not going to happen. And they're not going to be flying around in little ships. It's just, like, not going to happen. Sorry.
Do you remember the video that was released in the 90s at some point called The Alien Autopsy?
Yeah.
Did you ever see the alien autopsy?
Yes, I did, and it's incredibly realistic. No, it's just a rubber alien, isn't it?
Yeah, but there was like quite a lot of people who were convinced it was real for a while.
Well, there you go.
But the thing that gave it away was the telephone cable.
It was out of date.
It was a sprung telephone cable, whereas in those days they didn't have those things. So
Busted.
It was that, not the rubber alien on the bed.
Everything else checks out. It's just that one telephone cable.
Yeah, yeah. So what else can be said about UFOs? I mean, you know, is there anything else
I'm a skeptic. I'm a huge skeptic as far as the alien thing.
Okay. But, I mean, there must be aliens out there. I mean, the universe is so huge.
Must there? Yeah, there should be. But we don't know for a fact. We might be it. I mean, I'm not saying that's likely, but, you know, we don't know.
Isn't it weird that we exist, you know?
Yeah, massively.
Don't you think that just like the conditions on Earth were just right? It's like one in infinity chance.
Yeah, the chances against existing are almost infinite.
But don't
and you the chances, the likelihood of existing are like an infinity to one.
But don't you think that if you got a similar planet with similar conditions, where there's the same amount of water and oxygen and nitrogen it could definitely happen. I mean, you know how strong life can be.
Of course. I just like to think of every angle, but of course.
I just don't know if it's...
Logically, there must be. And they found other planets that are, you know, possibles recently, haven't they? Quite a long way away. I mean, they're not going to be much use to us, but...
Still. Interesting. I wonder what the aliens would look like. Would they be sort of super intelligent beings, like greater than us, or would they just be basically pond sludge?
I think they'd be like gas, sort of. They'd look like praying mantises.
Yeah.
But swim around in a sort of gas layer.
And they need that gas layer to stay alive, kind of thing. And they fart into it and they drink it and everything.
Yeah. And they're kind of, they have a society, but it's organic. It's not machines and concrete. It's just all organic. A bit like an alien, basically.
They have no economy. They just have plasma and sort of, you know, reproductive fluids.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, that's something to look forward to, at least. So the other thing in this clickbait episode
life hacks.
Life hacks. So have you got any good life hacks?
Have you got any life hacks?
Well, I don't know. I may be able to think of some if you give me a chance. But the one I've
thought of is poached eggs.
Mm-hmm.
It's basically just use a bit of vinegar in the pan.
Really? Just vinegar in the pan?
I should have built that up more, shouldn't I? But if you want perfect poached eggs, find out what this mum of three, chefs hate what this mum found out on blah, blah, blah.
Anyway,
when you're making poached eggs, a lot of people have different techniques. And there's the old school, like, poached egg maker, like the ones that mum and dad used to have. Remember them?
Yes, I do remember those.
Make little perfect little sort of, what would you call that shape?
Cups.
Little domes of
poached egg,
perfect made poached egg, which is, you know, kind of quite 70s.
Mm-hmm.
Then there's some people use the cling film method, which just sounds all wrong to me, but you wrap each egg up in cling film and dangle it over into the pan.
Okay,
that's kind of like what some like wankers do.
Wankers,
but I don't like the cling film getting that close to the egg in hot water, it can't be that good for it,
right? I would think so.
Some people use the vortex method, which is only for emergencies, but you stir the water in the pan really fast into like a whirlpool.
Yes.
And you drop the eggs into the middle. It's extremely dangerous. If you get it wrong.
Why is it extremely dangerous? Can you mess up the space-time continuum if you do it?
All sorts of things can go wrong. If you get it wrong and refuse cheap eggs, the eggs just immediately break up into contact with the water and just scatter all over the inside of the bowl. Which isn't what you want. If you get it right, they're kind of contained in this sort of the eye of the hurricane, so to speak.
Yeah, and they just poach perfectly.
But it's radical. That's when you haven't got any white wine vinegar. So what you really need to do is just put a splash of white wine vinegar in the pan. You'll get perfectly condensed.
Contained.
Perfectly contained, formed eggs.
Okay, that's great.
And I think the timing is just long enough to toast two slices of bread and butter them. that's about how long it would have time it.
I would say so. So do you think that just with that alone, that that justifies the presence of the phrase life hacks in the title of this episode, or do we need to give more? I feel like we need to give more.
A funny one. Did you see that British tea making video?
The British tea making video, the American woman. Yeah, you know what? You know what? I'm going to pull that up right now. Okay. Yeah, this went around the internet quite a lot.
I'm surprised she didn't delete her account.
Hold on.
She must have got so much hate.
Unless it was a joke. So I'm going to play the video. It's about 1 minute and 16 seconds long. And I'll describe what's going on. And then, James, you're going to talk about the British tea video then, are you? You won't be able to hear this, unfortunately, but my listeners will. Here we go.
Hey, guys.
Okay, so I should just say that this is like some kind of housewife in middle America somewhere. She's with her daughter. And she's basically saying, hey, guys, this is how you make British tea. And it's an abomination.
Hey guys, so I got a lot of questions after my last video, and everyone wanted to see me make hot tea or British tea, so today we are going to make tea.
So fill our mug with water, put it in the microwave.
So first of all, fill your mug with water. You should never fill the mug with water. You should be filling the kettle with water.
Just, I think it's funnier if you just let it play all the way through.
You reckon? Okay. Yeah. As long as they understand what's happening.
It speaks for itself.
Fill your mug with water, put it in the microwave.
Set it for a minute. Pour the milk in. Drop your tea bag in. Add the sugar. Give it a little stir.
And that's how you make hot tea. I get a lot of questions about...
Do we need to go back through that? Because James has disappeared.
Put it
in the microwave. Then you add the milk. Oh, what? And then you add the tea bag to the milk. And then you add sugar on top. No. All wrong. So, James,
I just like the smug way she says at the end, and that's the way you make British tea.
Like this.
And that's how you make hot tea.
That's how you make hot tea.
It's got to be guaranteed.
She describes it as British tea at the beginning, though, right? So I've had a lot of questions.
Hang on.
I want to know if she calls it British tea. Hold on.
Hey, guys. So I got a lot of questions after my last video, and everyone wanted to see me make hot tea or British tea.
Everyone wanted to see me make hot tea or British tea.
Right. Something I want to flag here.
Yeah.
She says something like, people have been asking to see me make British tea.
Yeah.
Bullshit. I do not buy that. No one has been asking her to see her make tea. That's just a lie. Straight off the bat, she's lying. And then she brings in the awkward daughter for some, you know, no need for that.
Mm.
It's just the whole thing's just, you know, I think it's kind of sparked off a bit of an international incident, didn't it?
Did it really?
Yeah, I think there was some diplomatic
confusion. You
know, banter.
Yeah.
On Twitter.
Confused diplomatic banter.
Anyway, that's that.
Well, okay. Good. So there you go. But you do not have a life hack for this? How do you make a cup of tea?
Well, the way you're supposed to do it, I'll quickly run through how you're supposed to do it. Get a pot of teapot, warm the pot with hot water, empty the pot, then get your tea caddy, or whatever it's called, put the tea in it, pour the tea over the blah, 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 blah.
Wait a minute. You get your tea.
Get one of those tea balls with a loose tea in it, put that in the teapot. That's probably the best way of doing it.
Okay.
And then leave it to stew for a bit, and then just get stuck in with a few people.
And milk in first, milk in second.
Start running low, just top it up with more hot water.
Milk in first, milk in second?
Milk in second.
Why?
Because it's just the way it should be.
But why is that, though? There must be a reason.
I don't know. I know
the reason.
Okay.
If you put the milk in first, you can't judge. You need to judge how much milk you should put in, so that's why you put it in second.
I mean, when you're mixing a paint, I don't know, forget it. I was going with that.
When you're mixing a paint, forget it.
You don't add... It's the other way around with paint, though. That's why I got confused. You don't add white to a colour make it lighter. You add colour to white to make it darker. Because otherwise you'll be pouring in about 8 litres of white to make a colour lighter.
I don't know how you do that, but that's good.
You take the one and But it's anyway. I'm sure I had some other stuff to talk about.
Life hacks. I'm trying to think if I have any life hacks. I really don't think I do. Climbing stairs. I have to climb a lot of stairs in my life because I live at the top of a building. Climbing flights of stairs. I have to climb 100 steps to get to my front door. So the trick for climbing if you're ever faced with a large number of steps you have to climb, the trick to it is to, well, there's two things. One is to completely distract your attention away from the climb itself. So you need to immediately start doing other things. Make lists in your head of stuff you need to buy from the supermarket. You need to quiz yourself, do quizzes. That's what I find helps. So it takes me about a minute, maybe 30 seconds to climb the stairs, and I do a little quiz on the way up, and it just distracts your mind from the fact you're climbing. That's the one thing. The second thing is, let's say it's in 5 sets of stairs. So when you hit set number 1, you have to imagine that is set number 0. Okay, the first set of stairs you hit is actually 0. And from there, you count 1, 2, 3, 4. And then when you get to the 4th floor, you're actually at the 5th floor, and it's a lovely surprise.
So that's insane. That's my, really insane.
It's not insane. That's actually very good advice, and you'll find it works. For anything like that, you start counting 10 things, you know, late, and then it's a surprise when you get to the end. You'll see it works. It really does.
Okay, good life hack. I think that's enough to justify the phrase life hack.
So what did we have in the title for this? We had life hacks. We had UFOs and something else, no?
There was something else.
COVID, wasn't it?
No, conspiracy theories, but we're not going to
do conspiracy theories.
We could do daft conspiracy theories.
What's the daftest conspiracy theory you can think of?
The Paul McCartney is dead one.
Yeah, I knew you'd bring that up. But that, you know what? That needs to be a whole episode on its own, I have to say.
We still haven't done an episode on the Beatles.
No, but again, that's another one that it's not just one episode. I can't even begin because I just want to
do the early years. We could do the Red Album and the Blue Album.
Maybe we could do that. But, you know, I'd have to start a whole Beatles podcast in order to do it justice. But I'm sort of building up to it. I'm just building up to it. I'm going to do the Beatles story one day. I'll just tell the story of what happened. It's an amazing story, but it's just a difficult one. It would be a few episodes long.
I've been watching the anthology again because you bought it for me. Thank you very much.
That's right. What do you think of the anthology?
It's just brilliant.
What is it for those people who don't know?
It's the story of the Beatles in a series of like 7 or 8 programs. And it's just interviews with the Fab Four or the remaining Fabs.
Mm-hmm.
With clips of John from when he was alive. But George was
still alive. Yeah.
Wasn't he? Yeah. Of course he was. So, yes, the three of them and lots of cool interviews and lots of good archive footage and interviews with everyone who was there and just tells the whole story from, you know, their childhood right up to the breakup.
Yeah.
They really were in that band from childhood.
Yeah, it's an amazing story, isn't it? I mean, it's got everything. It's got everything in it, that story.
And there's a lot of humour in it.
Yeah.
Like, it's very witty. They're very funny guys. I mean, that was always a big part of their charm.
Yes.
Their appeal was they were funny. I mean, they would have been pretty unsufferable if they were serious, wouldn't they?
Right. Yeah, totally.
Insufferable.
Insufferable.
You know, they would have been horrible, really. But because they had a good sense of humour, they were fantastic.
Did you watch a lot of the outtakes from the anthology as well, including the stuff of the three Beatles sitting around the table in George's house?
Yeah, playing those little guitars.
There's the ukulele section, but there's the bit when they're sitting around the table and they're talking about the times they met Elvis.
Oh, and they're saying, John jammed with Elvis. We all must have been in another room.
Yeah.
Because John told everyone that he jammed with Elvis and all this kind of stuff.
And George was saying that, like, you know, he doesn't remember because all he was trying to do was suss out from Elvis's guys if any of them had any reefer, as he said it. But they do talk about times when they met Elvis, and Ringo is saying, like, I met him a couple of times. I think it was at a party. And it's like, you know, that's it. Both times he met him was at that party. Like, he met him and then, like, you know, a few hours later, he met him again.
Yeah. You
know? And then George talks about meeting him in the 70s, and Elvis had the full-on sort of the big belt buckle and the big huge, what do you call those things that stick out of lapels on his jacket and everything, the white suit. And George is there and he's like all in denim and he's got long hair and a beard and he's like this grotty little troll. Like, hello, Elvis, how are you? Like that, like the way George tells the story. Hello, Elvis, how are you?
So did you ever...
was the bad leg?
Did you ever meet Elvis again?
I felt I'd met him several times.
You felt him?
Yeah.
Well, no wonder he didn't stand up.
Yeah. How do you mean you felt him?
We remember him well.
I have some memories that I met him several times.
But
maybe it was just the one night.
It was a long night. To him.
It's called flashbacks, I think.
Yeah. Hmm. I only met him that once. That night.
He was, when I saw him, I was like a hippie and I had all this denim on and I had long hair and stuff down to here. It was in the early 70s and I went backstage to meet him and, you know, those big dressing rooms, like, you know, miles of toilets and stuff. And so I was sitting there talking to the guys again and he was nowhere to be seen. And then finally he came round the corner and he had that big white outfit with all the gold things and the big belt buckle like this. And he looked like Ringo. He was all, his beard was varnished. No, he, you know, all his hair was black and he was all tanned and stuff. And he seemed like, I thought I was meeting Vishnu or, you know, Krishna or somebody. It was just like, wow. And I just felt like this little snotty, grubby little, you know, Elvis, how are you? You know, and he was like, hey.
I love it when George is talking about their MBEs as well. Mm-hmm. And he's so unimpressed. He's like, and they're so funny when they're talking about that because they're just like kind of laughing about it. And George is going, it's the lowest order you can get. And that's the best they can do. And he's like, we made London, we made the whole of Britain swing all through the 60s. Think of the amount of corduroy we sold. And they give us this little bit of tin with some rope running through it.
That's right.
It's so funny.
The titles that they were given after...
Member of the British Empire, the MBE, which is like a very low level of honour.
It's an honour. Yeah, that's right. The honour, the Queen's Honours list. You get the MBE, CBE, OBE, you know, Sir, Dame and all that stuff. Yeah, oh, there's so much to talk about. And, you know, Paul as well. I mean, Paul is great in the...
he's brilliant. He's a good storyteller.
Yeah, he is, actually. Well,
they all are, really, but...
I'm just trying to remember.
You can tell the bits that they're really happy about are kind of sort of... Well, all the way through to the middle, towards the end, really. And then the last few episodes, the last two episodes... Well, the last episode, really, they're kind of on a bit of a downer. And there's chaos. And when Brian
Epstein dies in 67.
It kind of all went a bit messy at that point.
Yes, it did, didn't it?
I mean, yeah. But, you know, it just had to be. I mean, it was also their best period in some ways, so.
Yeah.
You know, yeah, I'm a huge fan.
You know, I like doing the Paul McCartney impression. I had this idea that he's being interviewed and he's, like, convinced that he wasn't in the Beatles or that he's, like, didn't really do anything. Because, you know, normally in his interviews, he talks as if he sort of plays it down, but he bigs himself up at the same time. You know what I mean?
Like, humble brag.
You know, yeah, a lot of sort of humble bragging. And, you know,
we were just a great little rock and roll.
You know, yesterday it just came to me in a dream, you know, and I was taking it round going, have you heard this before? You know, it's got to be something. And the way he sort of like slightly rewrites history. But I thought it'd be funny to imagine that Paul McCartney is actually genuinely convinced that he wasn't really that big a deal in the Beatles. And
go on then, give us
so he's
give
like,
us
you know, he's sort of saying things like, you know, I sort of think to myself, you know, I was in the Beatles. You know, that's amazing. You know, that's crazy. You know, a lot of great music was made, you know. I think a lot of it was, you know, mainly John. I think it was mainly John. He was the main songwriter. And, you know, Ringo played a lot of great drums. And, you know, George, of course, was, you know, pushing the boundaries with the way he was playing the guitar. And, you know, I just came in, you know, played a little bit of bass. you know, just a little bit of bass here, you know, a little bit of vocals. And, you know, turned out really great. But I think it was mainly John who was the driving force.
There's did you see that?
Paul McCartney. Sorry?
Did you see that? Sorry, Paul. This.
What's that? You've got a chair that goes up and down.
Yeah, but it goes down when you don't want it to sometimes.
That must be fun for you.
So you're sitting there and then you'll just drop half an inch and then an inch.
Okay.
Like this. It's doing it now.
It's doing it now. I can see that you're slowly dropping.
It's fucking annoying.
This
sorry.
Is really riveting content for the podcast.
All right, what else have we got? I've got another life hack.
Oh, you got another life hack? Fantastic.
What do you do when you're really hungry
mm-hmm.
and all you've got is some flour, some self-raising flour, two eggs, two bananas that have gone way overripe,
mm-hmm.
some sugar
yeah.
and some butter.
And some butter.
You mix them all together into banana bread.
Mm.
So you need the butter to be soft, but you mix about a third of a pack of butter with like about half a cup of sugar.
Okay.
Into a paste. Then in the other bowl, you mix up the bananas and the eggs and then the flour.
Mm-hmm.
Then you mix them all together loads. And then you put it in a dish. In a little, you know, cake tin.
That's great. And then what do you do with it?
Well, take a wild guess.
Eat it?
Put it in the oven for about 35 minutes or a bit longer.
Okay, and then you eat it?
Then you eat it. It's very
great.
Nice.
That's great. So that is Jim's recipe for banana bread.
And I usually follow the BBC recipe, but I've stopped following it because it was a bit too rich. So I put a bit less sugar and butter in than they suggest.
What do you think of Jamie Oliver? Where do you stand on Jamie Oliver?
On his neck.
Hey.
You set him up and I'll knock him down.
Yep. So what do you think of Oliver, Jamie Oliver?
I try not to, really.
Why is that?
No, he's all right, I suppose. I think he overreached himself with his business plan.
I think we should do the impression.
Jamie's Italian, which was a bit shit.
His chain of restaurants.
But he was all right. I think his heart's in the right place when he tried to talk the Conservative government into giving healthier school meals, and they all just ignored him.
Yes, I think so.
Felt for him there.
I think, James, that we should do the impressions round. Okay? So I get to name an impression that you have to do, and then you return by naming an impression I have to do.
Okay.
Okay. So the first impression I would like you to do, and maybe I should give you a scenario that you've got to talk about as well. So you're selling insurance door to door. Okay. Going to people's houses, selling insurance, and you are Michael Caine. Go.
Open the bloody door. Open the bloody door.
Hello, how can I help you?
Right. I'm here to make sure that you and your loved ones don't get into a spot of bother. So all you have to do is sign on this dotted line and I'll make sure that you don't come to any harm. Is that all right?
Okay, thank you, Michael Caine. Very good.
Kind of went a bit wrong at the end.
It's all right. It's good. Not in the full Steve Coogan... Rob Brydon, sort of, you know, the whole, you know, the back of the throat thing.
No, well, that's been done, hasn't it? You can't try and copy someone else's impression.
Right, your turn for me then. Situation and an impression I have to do.
This person, I don't know if you can do them or not.
No, I don't know either. Well, we should
find out. Yeah. Okay, so the scenario is you're trying to buy some bread in a French boulangerie.
Okay.
And you're Hunter S. Thompson.
Hunter S. Thompson. Look here. So, I've come, because, I want to get... No, I can't do it.
That's Johnny Depp. Do Hunter.
Hunter, well, the thing about Hunter S. Thompson is that he does this kind of, when he says, it's like, that's it, isn't it? So, a lot of, fucking, you know, lots of, and then a lot of, very impossible to understand mumbling.
He leaves very good pauses.
So, I've come to get some fucking bread. Now that's become Barack Obama. Suddenly.
It's not an easy one, is it? It's something like...
how would you do, Hunter S. Thompson?
I just want to get some fucking bread and get out of here, for fuck's sake.
Yeah, I don't know. I can't do it.
could be that I might have to take one of these breadsticks and run the fuck out of here. I can't
and
do
why,
it.
And why not? Why not push why it as far as it'll go?
Take it all away.
Why not push things?
You know, eat one piece of bread.
Go.
Why not eat them all?
My turn for you. So you are returning a book at the library, and you are Harrison Ford.
I'm just doing Harrison Ford's confused face at the moment. That's the best thing about Harrison Ford, his confused face.
And then his shouting face that he does as well. Anyway, go on.
How you doing, old man? I'd like to take out this book on Wookiee dialect. That's it.
It started pretty good, but it went all wrong. So, went so English, Wookiee dialect. It went all English. Went all English. Isn't Han Solo, what's his name? Harrison Ford. Harrison Ford kind of speaks like this, isn't he? He's got the most lazy voice in Hollywood. Something like that.
What's that joke? In Dark Place, it goes, Harrison Ford used to be a carpenter. Some people say he still is.
Very wooden, his performances. So your turn for me. We'll do one more of these after this. Come on.
Noel Gallagher.
All right.
Buying a fridge freezer.
All right, so I've just come down here for to what's this fucking shop again? What is it? What's the name of the fucking shop?
Curry's, sir.
Curry's. Right, I've just come down to Curry's. Magnificent shop. Know what I mean? Those of like hi-fis and that. I used to have that. I had that one in the 90s. Listened to most of, recorded a lot of the demos for Definitely Maybe on that. I used to have that. Anyway, so I've come down here for a fridge. I want a big fuck-off fridge freezer from the kitchen. Want a big fuck-off fridge freezer from my kitchen. Right, have you got that fucking, what's it called? That fucking Red Dwarf thing? Smeg. Have you got one of them Smeg things?
You got one of them Smeg.
All right, yeah, I'll have a Smeg.
Make sure there's a lot of room for fucking, I've always,
you know, I've always wanted a Smeg, and I've always thought, yeah, why have they got fucking fridges called Smeg? There's something fucking weird about that. I want one. There you go. Noel Gallagher talking about buying a fridge.
All right, that's enough impressions, I reckon.
Okay, you think we're done? All right, then. I think that's probably the we've reached the
zenith.
Yeah.
One thing I wanted to see, what do you reckon the chances are of us getting Akai to give me a free NPC one to review?
How would you manage that?
I don't know.
By the way, James is talking about the Akai. It's a company that makes like stuff for making music, including the NPC 2000 and probably more now. NPC one.
But I'm a loyal Akai user, and with your huge listener base, you'd think they might want to like advertise there.
Okay, let's try
by sending me a free NPC one, which I will probably love and probably talk about on every episode.
Is Akai Japanese? I do believe it is, isn't it? It's either that or American, I'm not sure. But anyway, anyone listening who is connected to the Akai company that produces the NPC,
or knows anyone that is,
anyone who's got any contact with anyone at Akai responsible for producing the NPC one, which is the one that James is interested in, then get in touch with the show. Don't forget to like and subscribe. Okay, guys? But do get in touch with the show, because James is very interested in potentially receiving a new NPC one to test out, to review, maybe on the podcast. We could. We've already talked about his tunes that he's made on his NPC 2000, which are excellent. I think, you know, send us some free shit. Okay, great, thanks.
Worth
and
that, a try.
Any other companies listening, the same applies to you. Basically, I will talk about stuff. If you want to send me a new thing, I will say, hey, I got a new thing. Just send me free stuff, please. Feel free. Get in touch. Email.
You can put my SoundCloud page on this page if you like.
I will do that.
I've started using it again. I've actually filled up my SoundCloud page now. It's full.
Is it?
There's about 60, 70 tracks on there or something.
Full. God.
It's full. I have to delete one now if I want to put a new one up.
Oh, that sucks.
Not really, because they're not that good anyway.
Okay, well, you can just like get 60 or 70 excellent
bangers,
top tunes. Okay,
so check out my tunes, yeah.
Okay, I'll put the SoundCloud link on the page for this episode.
All right, and you're gonna use that tune. I haven't put that. You know that one that you like.
Yeah,
I haven't put that on SoundCloud, and I'm probably not going to. So at the moment, you've got an exclusive.
Okay, great. I've got an exclusive. Good. I'll put that maybe at the end of this episode, and I'll talk over the top of it. James, thank you for talking complete shite with me this evening. I hope that we can create a clickbait title for this episode that will do it justice. Cool. Listeners, thank you for listening. James, have a nice evening.
All right. And you, are we going to hang up now? Are we going to carry on talking?
I'll stop recording, and then we can just have a little chat and then finish.
Okay. All right.
Cheers then.
Bye, listeners.
So I hope you enjoyed that. It was really silly in the most fun way possible. I'm glad I recorded it. Thank you again to James for featuring in this episode. This tune in the background is one of James's own tunes made on the Akai MPC 2000. Those of you who work for the Akai Consumer Electronics Company over there in Japan, maybe. Those of you who work there, James's MPC 2000 is currently on the floor of his living room with the top off and all the circuits and boards visible. It's not looking good. There's something wrong with it and he needs a new one. So if you're in a position to provide him with an Akai MPC 1, that would definitely help him to help the podcast by providing more background music. Just get in touch with the show if you'd like to help out. And we will dedicate a special episode just to the wonderful Akai company and their delightful music-making machines. If you like James's stuff, if you like his music, I mean, that kind of stuff, if you like James's stuff, check out his SoundCloud page where you can hear most of his tunes. You'll find the link on the page for this episode, as usual. And as you may know, James is also a DJ. And since his MPC broke, he did a brand new LEP DJ set using his record decks and some new vinyl that he bought recently. That special exclusive DJ mix is now available on the page for this episode. It's also available on the music mixes page on my website. People sometimes say to me, Luke, why doesn't your brother do a podcast? Why doesn't he do videos? Why doesn't he contribute those sorts of things to the podcast? He doesn't have his own podcast or YouTube channel. He does have a YouTube channel where he puts skating stuff. It's called Video Days. VideoDaze. But he does do these music mixes. So he's got decks. He's got a microphone. Two turntables and a microphone, I think is the appropriate phrase. And he plays music and he talks between each track. So it's like James's radio DJ sort of radio show. He introduces the tracks and talks to them. And they are made specifically for listeners to this podcast. So you'll hear James introducing the tunes, speaking to you and DJing some music. Go to teacherluke.co.uk and under where it says Luke in the menu, click Music Mixes and you'll find all of his stuff. Alternatively, you can get the Mixcloud app for your phone and listen to it all there. Also, here's a link to James's Mixcloud page with music mixes across various genres, including drum and bass, dub, punk, hip-hop, and so on. That's Jim Thompson on Mixcloud. Also, you'll see that I've uploaded various music and comedy mixes myself onto my website. Teacherluke.co.uk, under where it says Luke, look for music mixes, and that's where you'll find those. And it includes these classic shows, the Classic Breaks Megamix, which is when I had a huge pile of CDs of rare groove, funk, and jazz records. And I had a mini disc player and a tape deck and some headphones, which I used as a microphone. And I recorded this 1 hour long mega mix of, it must be over 100 tracks all mixed together. And then I recorded myself doing an MC track over the top, but in a very silly impression of a New York DJ doing shout-outs and stuff like that. That's the Classic Breaks Megamix. There's the Moto Mix, which was done for a friend in Japan, and it contains lots and lots of stupid improvised comedy sketches by James and me, including impressions, characters, and voices all the way through it. It's a bit of a comedy music mix, really. That's the Moto Mix. Then there's Luke's radio show and the Walkman Mix. Both of those are just sort of normal sort of DJ mixes by me with talking. And also you'll find some of James's mixes there too. So there you go. There's some info about music mixes and James's stuff if you're interested in that. So then, I hope you enjoyed this episode. What do you think? I invite you to leave your comments. Have you heard any conspiracies recently? Have you heard any conspiracies about COVID-19? Ooh, I don't believe them. But anyway, they're quite interesting to talk about. Have you ever seen a UFO? Have you ever seen something like flying in the sky? You didn't know what it was. Do you believe that aliens exist? Do you think that they've made contact with us yet? Do you think that they might be posing? Do you think that maybe they are posing as us? Maybe they're posing, they're hiding. They've made contact with us already and they're already living among us. Who do you think might be posing as an alien in the world? Who would it be? Do you think Donald Trump, you know, is an alien? It's possible, I suppose. What was that Donald Trump thing I did on the podcast with Dad, where he's an English teacher? You know, he's going, people, there have been tremendous problems with language. I need to make that into a sketch. You know, because, you know, believe me, folks, I know grammar. I can help you. So who do you think might be an alien? Do you think I might be an alien? And finally, do you have any good life hacks? And on the subject of life hacks, here are some more life hacks just to justify the title. Okay, so here are a few more life hacks. Five fairly good ones that I found online, just in case you feel that there weren't enough life hacks in this episode. The meaning of the word hack here is something that makes your life easier. It's like a solution to a problem in life. We talk about life hacks, learning hacks for language learners, simple little tricks that you can apply that make your learning more successful. I think you know what life hacks are then, so here are five more half-decent ones just to make sure that you don't feel undersold by the title of the episode, which is not a sentence that many internet content creators feel the need to say very often, is it? Oh yes, after all, this video doesn't quite live up to the promise of its title. Sorry about that. Something you never hear, but I'd like to be different. So here we go. So five life hacks. First one is use a pillow from a sheet to keep... Wait a minute. Use a pillow from a sheet set to keep the sheets in. So you know you've got a sheet set for your bed if you need to change the sheets. You've got the fitted sheet. You've got pillowcases. You've got the duvet cover. Okay, and maybe a few other sheets. Maybe you've got another a sheet. Maybe you've got a valance that runs round the outside of the bed. What's a valance? It's the skirt thing that runs round the edge of the bed, as Alan Partridge said. So maybe you've got all these sheets and you clean them and you want to store them. What you can do is fold them up and then put all those folded sheets inside one of the pillow cases. Ah, use a pillowcase from a sheet set to keep the sheets in. All right. Here's another one. When you have to hang something with exact holes, photocopy the back and use it as a template. So let's say you're putting a shelf on the wall and you've got to work out where to drill the holes into the wall. Well, photocopy the underside of the shelf and use that as a template and then drill through the template. Yay! Here's another one. If you're drilling a hole in the wall, like I did the other day when I hung a guitar from the wall of my room here, I had to drill several holes in the wall to fit the hook. And so I've got a technique where I use a post-it note. Do you know what a post-it note is? One of those little sticky notes that you can stick on a desk or on a book or something. So you take a post-it note, you stick it just underneath where you want to drill the hole, and then you fold the paper up so that you end up with like a little platform just underneath where you're going to drill the hole. And then you drill your hole, and the little platform made of a post-it note catches all of the dust and all of the little bits of brick and stone or whatever it is, plaster. It catches it all in a neat little pile, and then you just take it off the wall and fold it up and throw it in the bin. So there you go, using a post-it note when you're drilling a hole in the wall. Extremely useful. It means you don't have to then get the vacuum cleaner out and clean it up afterwards. The next one is called the Pomodoro Technique. I've got no idea why it's called the Pomodoro Technique, but here it is. And it's a technique for getting stuff done, because it can be very hard to focus when you're trying to do work. You end up sitting at the computer, then suddenly, before you realize it, you're on Facebook or something. Here is a technique to help you get things done. So what you do is you work for 25 minutes and then you take a 5-minute break. Work for 25 minutes, take a 5-minute break. You can have a clock there counting down. After doing this 4 times, you take a 30-minute break. And you'll find that this will dramatically increase your productivity. And I definitely agree. When I was marking exams back in the days when I used to work at university, I used to have piles of 200 or more exams. I would set the clock for 10 minutes, blast through as many exam papers as possible in 10 minutes, and then perhaps mess around for a few minutes and then do it again. Set the clock for 10 minutes, go, blast through some more, the alarm goes off, I can just mess around for a while. And it made a huge difference compared to just trying to sit and work constantly, just focus for 10 minutes at a time or 25 minutes at a time, have regular breaks, and it really helps. Here's another one. If your phone is running out of battery and you need to charge it quickly, put your phone on airplane mode in order to charge it faster. It turns things off like the Wi-Fi and your data connection and stuff like that, and it allows the phone to charge much more quickly. But yeah, I think you probably already knew that one, didn't you? And finally, this one, which I don't know if it's a myth or not. You can tell me. It could be a myth. So let's say you've got a bottle of champagne, you've opened it, but you haven't finished it all. How do you keep it fresh and bubbly, so it's still fizzy, in the fridge? Well, the old technique is that you take a fork, you take it upside down, and you dangle the handle of the fork into the bottle of the champagne, and it keeps it fizzy. I think this is an old myth. I think it probably makes no difference, but I'm mentioning it anyway. Because there is a Noel Gallagher story. You heard me, right, doing my Noel Gallagher earlier on, right, in this episode, yeah? You know what I mean? You heard me do a Noel Gallagher earlier on. Well, this is Noel Gallagher telling a story about dangling a fork into a bottle of champagne to keep it fizzy. And by the way, when Noel mentions our kid means our kid, meaning his brother, Liam. So when he mentions our kid, he's talking about Liam. So listen to this little story about whether or not it makes you should dangle a fork in a bottle of champagne to keep it fizzy. What happened? I'll explain it afterwards, but I'll let you try and work out what's going on.
In the break, you told us, I said, come on, you must have another story. And then you started telling one. I went, no, wait till everyone here.
Okay, I've got to start. It is out there, but it makes me chuckle. Every time I even think of it.
Do you need to blank out years and dates?
No.
Okay.
So some of your posher listeners will be aware of the something physiological happens when you open a bottle of champagne, or sparkling wine.
Blue Nun.
Depending where you come from.
Yeah.
I never seen this till I moved to London. To keep it, you would keep it fresh, you would put a fork upside down in the thing, and the handle would be down into the bowl. I could never understand why it kept champagne fresh, but by Jesus, it did. Mm-hmm. And I only knew this when I moved to London. Anyway, so our kids round at my house one night, and he opens the fridge, and there's a bottle of champagne in it with a fork in, and he says, "What have you got a fork in the bottle of champagne for?" And I said, "Well, it keeps it fresh, does it?" I said, "Yeah, it keeps it fresh." And he went, "I'm not having it." And I said, "That champagne is 2 days old. Still fizzy." And he's like, "No way, that's amazing." About a week later, I went round to his house. He had a fork and a pint of milk. I've not even embellished that. That's a proper true story.
Okay, so did you get it? So basically, Noel's there in his house. Liam comes round, our kid, and opens up the fridge, and there's a bottle of champagne with a fork in it. And Liam's like, "All right, what have you got a fork and a bottle of champagne for?" Well, that's my Liam impression. What have you got a fork in that bottle of champagne for? All right, fucking Liam Gallagher, aren't I? From Manchester. I was in Oasis, man. All right, mad for it. And Noel says, "It keeps it fresh, keeps it fizzy. That champagne's 2 days old." And Noel, Liam's like, I'm not having it. I'm not having it. I mean, I don't believe it. And then apparently a couple of days or a week later, Noel goes around to Liam's house, opens up the fridge. There's a bottle of milk with a fork in it. Yeah, there you go. That's Liam Gallagher for you. And of course, the milk was not fresh. So there you are, ladies, my lords, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much for listening to this latest episode of Luke's English Podcast. And as I said earlier, if you like those moments on the podcast when I start speaking in different voices, you know, like this kind of young posh, this young posh chap that I'm doing right now. Yeah, I know, you know, William and Harry. Yeah, pretty good mates with them, actually. Yeah. So if you like those moments on the podcast, right, when I start doing voices and things, you should listen to that Moto Mix. I'll put it on the page for the episode. Thank you for listening. Speak to you again on the podcast soon. I look forward to reading your comments. But for now, it's time to say goodbye. Bye, 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 bye. For listening to Luke's English Podcast. For more information, visit teacherluke.co.uk.